Welcome to the Ham Planet podcast. Subscribe and share to support the show.
But like, you know, like for me, rugby really, like, no matter where you go in the world, yeah. If you don't know anybody, find your local rugby club, and then I promise you, you'll find the best people.
The best people. Exactly.
Howdy there, folks. It's your man, Peter Ham, checking on in here, giving a quick prelude to today's historic episode to let you guys know that today's show is dedicated to the Dallas Jackals. Todd Gleaver.
Todd Gleaver played in the Premiership for Gloucester. He's a hooker.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Oh, probably, yeah. Yeah, it's probably like 5
I've seen him out there.
He used to be 6'2", but he's been playing so many games in the Premier League as a hooker that he shrinked.
Wow.
Yes, and now, like, by the end of the season, I can hold him in my hand, probably. Put him on my shoulder. You know what I mean? But he's still a great player.
You love to see it.
Yeah, I'll show you by the end of the season.
that'd be an amazing magic trick.
Like you seen like the Hangover with the baby, okay? I put him on right here and I bring it to you. He can be on the show with you. He can be on the show with us.
Oh, you know? I love that.
He'd be a little man with a beer. He'd be Benjamin Button.
Salute to him.
Hey Todd. Don't you love you?
Lift off at dawn. The new era of American space exploration.
Shall we head to my favorite planet in the galaxy? The planet of good vibes. The planet of good vibes.
The planet of good vibes. The planet of good vibes.
Planet podcast.
Blasting off into the galaxy of good vibes in the proximate 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1. Top of the morning, folks. Good afternoon and good evening, ladies and gents. Welcome to the Ham Planet podcast. I'm your host, Peter Ham. And if you're new to the show, I love to see it. In all caps, I love to see it. I really do. So make sure to subscribe. Stop what you're doing right now. Please subscribe. It helps beyond measure. And if you're new to the show, I'll preface the show by saying that we're about three things here at the Ham Planet Podcast. Just simple as that. Good vibes, great people, and glorious stories. And we will have an abundance of all three of those today, folks. Ladies and gents, today we got two special guests. Representing the good old Dallas Jackals of the MLR of Major League Rugby, and couldn't be more excited to jump right into it. Our first guest is Alex Tucci, aka Slim Tucci. Alex has traveled the world playing rugby. He's played in Ireland, Utah, Florida, Texas, and I'm sure there's plenty more. But it was a great honor to get to meet him, and definitely looking forward to being a good brother of his as time goes on. He's a definition of a guy who's a grinder. He has persevered even when the odds were against him. He bet on himself and turned out pretty damn good, because now Alex Tucci is playing professional rugby for the Dallas Jackals. Secondly, we have a great friend who I've had the honor of sharing the pitch with many times, Romain Gadeau. That's actually his name. It's AKA French. But ladies and gents, Frenchie clearly comes from the heart of France. He's a character like none other. He's someone who has so much passion for the game of rugby that it just oozes through his pores. And he's a damn good man. He's hilarious, and he's also an exceptional father to his beautiful little daughter. So shout out Girl Dad Gang. With that being said, ladies and gents, let's give it up for Mr. Alex Tucci and Mr. Romain Gadeau. It's like some nunchucks, boys.
Yeah, I was gonna say,
have y'all ever used nunchucks?
It's more so like a stapler.
Yeah.
fucking stapler nunchuck.
It used to be one of the actual like things they use in the movies, but it broke because it's a shitty one from China.
Sure they don't spend money on them that much anyway, so we just like you know.
Yeah, it was super glued to the other. It is what it is.
Yeah.
Brother, happy to have you in Dallas.
Oh, I'm happy to be here, honestly.
I know you probably came a long way as a rugby warrior your entire life, or at least for a healthy portion of it. So, brother, what is the Alex Tucci rugby journey?
The rugby journey starts when I was about 14, I want to say. Before, up until about 13, I was a baseball player that I transitioned to like in 10th grade to American football.
Were you playing DH?
No, baseball. I was a pitcher and first baseman.
Damn, I didn't know that.
No way.
I didn't know that about you.
Hell yeah.
Fuck.
Yeah, I used to just love it. I used to love baseball. When you grow up, when you grow up in New York, it's like kind of like I would say back then baseball was very very popular. Growing up in the Bronx, Yankees, all that.
How old again? This high school.
This is up until high school, so ninth grade, and then Went to football, and then in the off season I had like to choose between, you know, wrestling, basketball, track and field. It was mostly between wrestling and track and field. And I didn't want to do any of that. This really wasn't feeling it. And my friend was like, hey, he sent me a video and was like, hey, do you want to go play rugby? And I was like, what is that? Saw the classic, like, Here Comes the Boom video. If you look it up on YouTube, it's like really bad quality, but I think it's everybody's
first. If you're a rugby player, you know that video.
Introduction to rugby. So then went out to a practice, did that, got my mom to sign all the forms. She didn't care. She was just like, fine, you want to go run into things? Go for it.
Did your mom know what it was?
She didn't know. She has no idea. She just kind of, but she does find it more entertaining than football. So it's easier to follow, you know?
See it. Love it. Love to see it. Back to the show.
They're what the Thug Life glasses originated from.
The Thug Life. Yes!
This is like the grandfather.
Yes.
So I'm paying homage to Thug Life, which I mean.
I need to watch it. I watch my language. I drop a lot of F-bomb.
Brother, you can drop an F-bomb. This isn't a children's network.
Yeah, okay, good.
It's not. I mean, it's just.
Yeah, all right.
It's for adults like yourself.
Yeah, degenerates.
I'm not really an adult. But I'm a degenerate.
I was like 40. I'm not an adult. Okay, Gary V.
Yes.
Gary V. I don't feel old.
Gary V. Gary V would not do too hot on a rugby pitch.
No, nah, man. It was like a weasel.
Most people wouldn't because they just would get hit one time and be like, oh my God, I'm broken. But they'd be fine, honestly.
Yeah,
I think.
Exactly.
Right.
You know?
They wouldn't survive that first break. You're
just
Gucci.
I've seen like small people just get destroyed on. This guy tried to clear me out, and I got one of my hands under his face, and I just like put all my weight on top of him and just flattened on top of him, and he was hurting. But I mean, he ended up
that's part of the game.
You should see some of the guys in our team. They're not like big bodies, but like I can tell you, man, they have more like winning or smashing people than bigger guy. You know what I mean? Like our number nine is probably a small guy, but when you put him in the field, he's like a dog. Yeah, Todd, a hooker, is probably like 5 feet tall.
Let's give Todd a full shout out. What's Todd's full name so we can root for him?
Oh, fuck, Todd Gleaver.
Shout out Todd Gleaver.
Todd Gleaver played in the Premiership for Gloucester. He's a hooker.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's probably like 5 feet.
I've seen him out there.
He used to be 6'2", but he's been playing so many games in the Premier League as a hooker that he shrinked.
Wow.
Yes, and now like by the end of the season, I can hold him in my hand probably, or put him in my shoulder. You know what I mean? But he's still a great player.
You love this. You love to see it.
Yeah, I'll show you by the end of the season.
that'd be an amazing magic trick.
Like you seen like The Hangover with the baby can. I put him on right here and I bring it to you. He can be on the show with you. He can be on the show with us.
Oh, you know? I love that.
He'd be a little man with a beer. He'd be Benjamin Button.
See the thing that makes your beer consumption so much more economical.
You have a celebrity.
Bro, he could swim in a beer.
Exactly. you have T-Rex arm, like very short T-Rex, legs.
Yeah.
But he's a great guy.
Like the dog.
Yeah, it's like the dog. It's like your dog.
Shout out Rocky.
Shout out Rocky.
Rocco the unit.
Rocky.
Rocco the unit.
Yeah. Rocky is probably taller than him. But I love the man.
He's brother, a great guy. We salute to him.
Hey, Todd. Frenchie, love you.
Oh, fuck. That was great. That was
great. You love to see it, boys.
Oh, yeah, I do.
I love to see the Dallas Jackals camaraderie.
Yeah, no, it's a tight-knit group for it sure. Is.
High and the brotherhood strong. Oh, yeah. That's what's going to win championships.
It,
yeah.
It came fast, too.
It came really fast.
It came fast.
Yeah.
Well, hell yeah. So, boys, back to where we were.
Yeah, where were we?
We were...
Tucci.
Yeah.
Welcome back to the Good Old Hand Planet podcast, ladies and gents. We'll say it to ya. And Tucci.
Yeah, yeah.
We were discussing the rugby journey. You were playing baseball in the Bronx.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You were loving it. First base, pitcher. Then you had to choose a winter sport. Or
yeah, so once I... Well, it was when my mom moved me to Florida. So we're living in Florida at this time. And
what age? Could we get age
let's
stamps,
get like
brother?
A, let's Tucci? Get like... Move to Florida when I was 12. And then, you know, I think I did 8th grade, 9th grade. I was still playing baseball. And then 10th grade. 9th grade, basically... I basically beat out a ground ball like to like third base and just like got on first, and I would steal bases as like a big kid, which was like, and my coach was like, listen, you're really fast and quick, like go play football, you'll have a great a career. So I mean back then you could have told me to do anything, I would have just gone and done it, but just went and played football, and like I said, once it got done, I just needed another sport to play. And rugby, they were like, listen, you can run the ball. And I was like, well, I can run the ball. It like gave me flashbacks to, like, you know, just
playing Madden with Michael Vick.
Yeah, or just even playing pickup with my friends. Like, I would just be like, give me the, like, if we needed this score, just give me the ball and just run over all my friends to go score. So, I mean, when it came time, when I got to do that in rugby, that's when I kind of, I guess, got the first love of rugby.
Your
freshman
year, Tucci?
No, sophomore. So I'm like 14. And then played football and rugby all the way up until I was done with high school. I had offers for like Division I football schools, and I had an offer to go to Life University for rugby. But at that time,
Jeez,
man!
But at that time, it just was so like the rugby road was so just like. You didn't know where it was going to go in America.
Yeah.
So they were like, listen, go do your football.
Get a scholarship.
Get your scholarship. Go to a big university. Have fun. And then when you're done playing football, you can always come back to rugby. And that was basically my mindset. And then I did 3 years at Colorado State. And before I transferred from Colorado State, I played a year of rugby. And, like, you know, got back into the game. The rugby team there knew I played rugby, but I just couldn't do both at the same time.
Yeah.
Football's too much of, like, a commitment. So then after that, I... went to West Texas A&M, finished out my football career, did three years there, and then had like a workout with the Dolphins. And then once I did that workout, I did a couple of CFL like just tryout like they do like around in Dallas and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I just was like, all right, I'm done with this. Like I didn't think football was gonna really like be the. I loved the game, but like it just was sort of like I didn't want to be one of those people really just chasing it the whole time. Nothing against it, but I just knew it wasn't for me. Went back home, just started working out, training, and one of my friends was like, hey, come back out and play rugby. And I was like, oh, yeah, hell yeah.
What year are we at now?
This is like probably 2015.
Okay.
So yeah. Then get back into rugby and playing club, and did a whole season out there out in Weston, which is where I grew up when I moved to Florida, which is like a suburb in Fort Lauderdale, I would say it as. It's in the Broward County area.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
So yeah, went back there, started playing with my team again. And
what team?
It's called a Weston Wandering Okapi, and Okapi's like a zebra giraffe mix, I think, or something like that.
Impressive.
Yeah, it's a crazy animal,
bro. Rugby teams be coming up with some crazy shit.
When we were in high school, we were called the Weston Lancasters. What's a Lancaster, you may ask? You, it's an old like bomber from like World War II or something.
I was thinking it was something I saw on the History Channel.
Yeah, yeah. It was just the weirdest name to be called because people were like, it could have been anything.
I didn't know.
And they were like Lancaster, but it was fun. But yeah, so
shout out to them.
Shout out Weston Lancasters, the original first rugby team in Florida. Florida.
Hey, it's still nice, big bro. Deal.
Yeah. It's all good.
Okay, so you're what? So now 24 at this point?
Frick, I might be like 25, honestly. Yeah. I'm probably like 24, 25. somewhere around there. And then my friend Steven, he was like, after I got done with that first club season back, my friend Steven was like, hey, do you want to go to Ireland with me and play like just club rugby out there?
Yeah.
Get our like skills better, learn the game more, travel a bit. And I was kind of like, yeah, I mean, I was broke at the time. I actually started a GoFundMe.
Damn.
And got it, but I was like, I'm going out to Ireland. Anybody want to help out with travel expenses and blah, 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 and just living out there?
Hell yeah.
It's just to like further my rugby career. I knew Major League Rugby was starting. So my main thing was to go out there, get film, learn how to play in a proper system, and further, like, because I've been away from rugby for so long, you know?
So you were just like, hey, I'm going. Did you go to Ireland again? Just, like, did you already have, like, a team set up?
No, my friend.
Oh, shit. Okay, that's what I was saying.
My friend that had a friend that played in college with, that was a foreign exchange student that he played rugby with at Florida.
Yeah.
And he was like, his friend said to him, like, hey, come out and play a club season. He was like, well, I got another guy that's pretty good. He could be like a professional in this sport. Like, I want to bring him out and like basically, you know,
yeah,
just get better at rugby. And that's what I did. I went out there and played. I had an agent at the time, Gavin McCleavy.
Shout out Gavin.
But so I would send my film back to him. I would send my film back to him.
Love to see it, Gavin.
And he would just, you know, distribute it amongst, and he ran into the owner of the Warriors at the time. I was only in Ireland for 3 months, so it wasn't a long time, but it felt like a long time.
That's still pretty cool, man.
Yeah.
You travel, you know, like the fact that rugby gave you the chance.
Bro, I mean, that's a long time.
I lived with this guy, Lar. He was like a Frenchie of the team, essentially.
Yeah.
Just
a Frenchie of the team.
Just a Frenchie of the team. If you know Frenchie, you know.
Yeah, if you know, you know. If you don't, then
you just got to hang out with the guy and see what I'm talking about.
Got to have the privilege.
Yeah, exactly. Got to have the privilege. So, basically got my agent basically ran into Kimball, who's the owner of the Warriors, and just was like, saw he had an MLR hat on, was like, here, yeah, this guy. And then, you know, talked a couple Zoom calls and stuff like that. By that time, honestly, I was ready to get out of Ireland. I was broke.
Didn't know when you're coming back.
When did you go to
three? I knew I was coming back in 3 months at least.
Yeah,
because that's when the visa was gonna go up. So I, but at the same time, like, I just went out there without, I just said, like, what, my family was like, what are you gonna
true
do?
Rugby renaissance adventure.
Yeah, exactly. Literally, like,
I'm going to Ireland, submerged. I'm playing rugby.
But I mean, but that's cool, man. Like, traveling like over there and then learning a different skill. Like, I mean, I bet you eat a lot of potatoes and you can understand, like,
honestly, the food, the meat in Ireland was some of the best. Like,
they know what they're doing.
Like, with the meats, like cows, chicken, like pork, it was all really, really good.
But can you understand what they speak?
Some of them you couldn't understand.
Yeah, they speak like potato language.
They would.
Like, they do like two potatoes in the line, like.
You know, it can be tough.
Yeah.
It can be tough.
Yeah, because I know a lot of Irish boys here. Shout out to my friend Wiz.
Shout out Wiz.
You know Wiz, right?
Of course.
Yes. Should I Wiz potato eater?
Wiz takes a few times.
Yeah, to understand.
Talking to him. Yeah. And once you got a feel for it, though, you can start talking the language, which is even more fun.
Well, you do if you don't understand what he says. You just say yes.
The craziest part about being in Ireland was, like, I just worked some odd jobs. Like, I mean, it was just, I was a pain. Like, I ran out of money, and I was like, I told, like, our coach, I was like, I need to earn money. Like, somehow, some way. Like, I'm thinking,
I need to eat.
In America, like, it's very, like, easy to go get under the table cash jobs.
Yeah.
Sure.
Like,
you
go, like, cut, you know, someone's grass, or, like, cut the whole block's grass, get money if you really were that desperate.
True. Land of opportunity.
Land of opportunity. Exactly. But out there, it's so, they use a lot of, like finance people that do their taxes and papers and run their numbers and stuff. So businesses really can't do it out there. It's a lot stricter.
Yeah.
But I worked as a painter for like a month, and it was tough. And I'm just like, it was just funny.
Painting is a workout.
And it's like commercial painting. Yeah. So we're inside
all day you're like this.
We're inside their Costco, and just like, I'm there wearing these white paint pants. Like
white ducks.
Yeah.
That's what they're called ducks.
I'm wearing a black wife beater.
Yo, that's gangster.
And a pair of Jordans.
So you look like a fucking.
I looked insane.
You
like
were people, ready people for are looking at me Irish like, rap
yo,
video.
What no, is you going
look, you
on?
Look like, you look like a porn video actor.
I just
I'm
looked,
here to paint your fucking.
I looked
room.
Out of place. But I mean, like, and then the guys I would work with would just, they, you, like you said, you can't understand. I didn't understand them, but there was this one kid that I was actually working with who was like, he was like an apprentice.
Yeah.
But he was like the guy that I hung out with the most. We had to, sometimes we'd climb, we'd do like 4-story buildings. I'm like up 3.5 stories.
Doing the roofs?
With a paint, with a
paintbrush. Were you doing the ceilings and shit too?
Not just the side of the building.
Yeah.
So I'm like leaning against the ladder, like, and I'm like, what the fuck am I doing here?
You should have, yeah.
It was always, I mean, like I said, like, if like the purpose of going out there was just to like engulf myself in rugby.
Yeah.
It's so hard to do that in the States because of just like, it's not really the culture.
It's
football,
not.
Football, basketball. You can engulf yourself in football. You can engulf yourself in basketball. You can engulf yourself in baseball, like anywhere in America.
Right.
But for rugby, it's so hard because there's tight-knit groups.
It's growing every year, though, rapidly.
Yeah, it is growing rapidly. I do have to say that, but it's just like to go like...
Right, like Ireland's, that's their game. That's her number one.
I wanted to play with people that played when
actually,
they were
it's not number game.
Kids,
number game is number game is Gaelic football.
Gaelic football,
Did you go to a game?
I went to a couple games, yeah.
Did you understand the rule?
Yeah, it's like, you know, it's like speedball. We play at practice sometimes.
But did you know, like, all of those players are amateur? None of them are professional.
Have you watched hurling?
Yes.
Hurling is nuts.
Do you know they play in New
What's
York?
Hurling?
Hurling is like hockey.
It's like,
you know?
Hockey, and then they hit the ball, and I don't even understand.
So it's like you know, like grass hockey?
Yeah, yeah.
The thing when you can pick up the ball and just smash it. You smash it as far as you can, and then you play with like a stick, like a short stick.
Yeah.
And you can hit the ball or whatever at other people.
Like shoulder, like
you can like
check.
Shoulder check.
Shoulder
it's
check.
Like, it's crazy.
Shoulder
sport.
Check. It's the one of the fastest sport, fastest sport ever. And then you can score between the.
It's almost like a mix between like Australian rules football and Gaelic football.
Yes.
It's weird.
Gaelic football is a very good sport, man.
Yeah.
I think a ball or a sport with like a stick and a ball. I would be ass hot. Like, I wouldn't be good.
Yeah, you'd be surprised.
No, lacrosse. You know lacrosse?
People always feel that
like
way
lacrosse?
About baseball, I feel like.
You like lacrosse?
I tried baseball. I didn't try lacrosse. I actually had to
actually,
choose.
Actually, by the way, there's a pro team in Fort Worth, the Rattler. You need to go see them. Shout out to the Rattler in Fort Worth.
Shout out Fort Worth Rattlers lacrosse program.
Yes, sir.
It's a pro team, too. They just started it.
Pro team. But most importantly, shout out to the Dallas Jackals.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
We are fired up. Boys, what has the experience been like being able to play in front of the hometown Dallas-Fort Worth crew with, you know, a city backing a team?
Yeah.
Hometown team.
What
does it feel like, man?
It was really cool to see that many people at a first home game. And I was saying to Frenchie when we were leaving, I was like, I feel like we haven't really even tapped into the Dallas market yet of just like how many fans we can actually bring to a game. I mean, Dallas fans, Dallas Cowboys, some of the most loyal fans, I feel like, in sports.
Right. Oh, yeah.
And,
I'm big Cowboys fan.
America's team.
I mean, it's Dallas' team.
The Dallas Jackals are America's rugby team.
Yeah, I hear that. I hear that actually a lot. I hear that a lot.
Yeah.
Blue-collar team, you know?
Yeah, we are
can relate to us.
Putting the sword in the ground.
Yeah, by the way, the first home game that we had 3,100 supporter, which is huge.
That's a lot, and
that's a lot.
I mean,
it's just the home.
I've heard a lot about just Dallas rugby in general, and I know there's a bunch of teams out here. So I mean, it's got the roots.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
It's got the grassroots. Yeah. I do have to say.
True. The DFW has like 3 D1 team who's with the highest level before professional rugby. So you have the Dallas Reds.
Yep.
We have the Dallas Harlequins. You have the Austin Blacks. You have the Hunts. Shout out to all those team. And then you have the development squad from Houston, who's like HTX.
HTX.
Development squad for the Sabercat.
Yeah.
Which is huge because compared to other state, like
you really don't get that.
Other state. Like even like when you're from Florida, I don't think you have any D1 team.
Everything is D2. I mean, the couple they get put into the D2 bracket, but most of it's D3, D4 rugby.
So the level in Texas is huge.
Just
It's huge.
So that's it's huge.
Like, yeah, it's huge. It's weird because Florida has a good rugby community. Like, there's a lot of people out there. I just feel like it's very transient. Yeah. So, like, there's like they're coming and going
and
a lot.
Like, yeah, now
but now it seems like my club definitely in Florida, like the Western Wandering Okapis, they got a really good like youth system, and there's actually now got it's like became a club for a long enough time where you're having guys that played for the high school team come back and play for the men's team.
That's huge, yeah.
So that's that's a big thing.
Yeah, it's huge. And that's why like we have a big – and then you get Grand Prairie too. Grand Prairie just joined the D1 league this year. So we have like three D1 club, established D1 club.
Yeah, get up in there, Frenchie. Yeah, pull it around if you need to. Well, don't
throw it out. That's Frenchie's used to that. So, like, I mean,
well, don't do it with the mic. Someone else already did that. Yeah,
when he comes to my room and when I'm streaming, he's always trying to mouth the mic, and I'm just like, you can't do that. Can't do that. Oh.
It's not true, by the way.
Oh, it's very true. Okay,
it's the French in him.
Yeah. We love everybody and anybody.
Yeah.
All right. From the people for the people.
What a beautiful thing. What a beautiful thing, yes. Ladies and gentlemen.
But like I said, like in the DFW just by himself, we have three D1 team. Like
yeah, we
the
have
Reds,
a,
the Queens.
A massive like tree branch. Of
exactly. Yeah, definitely.
And it's huge compared to any other state, you know what I mean?
I mean,
bigger than anyone else I know.
Yeah. And if you like shoot out to the Austin Blacks, who've been to the national championship final for 3 years in the past 5 years, if I'm not wrong, you know what I mean?
Yep.
Which is huge. You know what I mean?
And yeah.
They came short a couple times, but I know you guys are going to get it pretty soon. So and I hope my queen's going to get it soon, okay?
It's cool to see because it's like there's different – you could definitely see the different cultural changes because I'm from – but my first MLR team I played for was Utah, and I was there for the past 4 seasons. And, yeah. I mean, you know, you see they have their own, like, I guess – shield they play for, like the club teams, and it's like a Polynesian league in a sense, but I mean anybody could play in it, but it's some of the guys in there you see, they're just, you know,
units.
Whoa.
Well, Polynesians, they have extra human growth hormone already like inside of them.
Is that true?
Yeah,
that's what I heard. I mean, I'm not a scientist, a doctor, or a financial advisor. But I think that it's true.
It's true, man. The biggest rugby player I ever seen were from
Islanders, yeah.
Man.
But yeah, no, like I was saying, like I mean, you see a lot of like similarities as far as like Utah has such I guess great pipelines from their pro team down to their club teams, and it seems like Dallas is following that. Like what I could see from the first year of being on the team with Dallas is they want to make sure that they implement the DFW area in general into the team as much as they can.
True. Like, I don't know if you...
And, like, as logically as they can.
Yeah, I don't know if you ever play against Grand Prairie, but Grand Prairie is just manly Islander team.
Oh, yeah,
shout
I know.
Shout out to Coach Stiddy, by the way. They have, like, the whole community about Ulysses.
Yeah.
Grand Prairie. So it's just a bunch of Islander.
Oh, yeah,
and
I know.
Those
guys are freaking nasty.
Massive, man.
Yeah.
They're pretty lazy, but they're massive.
But when they want to
make them run more,
when they want to turn it on, though,
have a target on his back.
When they want to turn it on, it's
on.
It's game on.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But also, they're the nicest people in the world. Like
they're all.
When they have you on the good side, they love you. But I don't want to be on the wrong side of them. You know what I mean? Because
I mean, I feel like for most rugby men, guys who it's like it's their game.
Yeah.
They're always. Outside of the pitch and outside of the weight room, outside of the just
great people.
Smooth like butter.
Yeah.
Yes.
100%. I can definitely
they're the sweetest
men
in the world, man. Sweetest.
Yeah.
But when they get on the field, they like they don't know how to go tackle low. They tackle pretty high. Like,
yeah, Frenchie. Right? Frenchie's favorite tackle is high.
Well, Frenchie, you've been tackling people for a long time, brother.
Yes.
When did you start?
So, okay, my story is like I started playing rugby when I was 9 years old because I was a little chubby, I would say. And my
You're
grandparents.
A fat kid.
Yeah, I was fat. Yeah,
it's okay.
Yeah.
I was too.
I was like the guy from the Goonies, they're like, blah, blah, blah.
You chunk.
Yeah, I was chunk.
And this is what?
9 years old.
Nine years old.
If we can get locational stamps.
So I was raised by my grandparents because my dad passed away when I was one. My mom came from Tahiti. With me and came to Paris.
Love that.
Yeah, and then I was raised by my grandparents, so I was with them. And by the age of 9 years old, they were like, hey, you think you the food is pretty good at home, but I think you need to take care of your, you know, health a little bit. So I wanted to play soccer.
Let's get running.
Yeah, I wanted to play soccer. And since I was bigger, because all my friends were playing soccer at the time.
Yeah.
I was bigger than everybody. So I started, hey, let's just try rugby. So I tried rugby first time and I got hooked on. So I've been playing rugby.
And this at 9 years old?
Yes, 9 years old.
See, like...
Pee-wee.
That's non-existent.
No, it's not existent here in the U.S., but I hope we can develop that and really push that. You know what I mean? Like, develop. Like,
hell yeah,
you know,
it's the best
younger,
sport.
The younger you start, the better it is, because...
Yeah, your body, it comes second nature.
Exactly, and your body get conditioned to, like, you know, the heat.
Yeah.
And how to fall on the ground and stuff, so...
Yeah.
I played there for until the age of 15. Then I moved to Brittany. Brittany is... actually, I moved to...
Brittany? Is that
West Coast?
Britain?
Yes, Britain. Mm. Britain, West Coast of France, close to England.
I speak Texan, brother, so you got to clarify sometimes.
Sorry. I went to boarding school over there. Boarding school for over there for 5 years. And
for high school, boarding school?
Yep.
Love that, brother. Me too.
Oh, I loved it. Some of my best year ever. Yeah. Like right now, I feel like right now, I feel like in boarding school with all the boys living in
hell
the same apartment.
Yeah, definitely. Was yours...
yes. It's like a Friday house.
Was yours military?
Yeah, no, it was not military, but it was boys only. We had kids from 15 to 25 years old.
25? What the hell are 25-year-olds doing?
Because they were
PhD? So,
no. That school that I had, people were training to become an officer in the Marine.
The Army?
No, not the Army. The
Navy?
Air
Force?
No.
Coast Guard?
Hold on! Like when you know, like those big tanker who do like
submarines.
No, so, like transport big
cargo ships.
Yes, cargo ship. Mm.
So you know, that's not part of the military.
It's not part of the military. It's
the captain, the ship. The
captain of the ship, but they call him officer in the ship. You have the captain. You got different officer. If it's not military, they call them captain.
You still got to be a captain. Yeah,
you call me an officer.
We need those guys. I mean, yes. We got shit floating out in the sea.
Exactly.
You know.
So like
that's why Toys R Us went out of business.
Yes.
That's crazy.
Exactly. So yes, I was there from 15 guys from 15 to 25. So I grew up faster.
So you were from France, now Britain, for all of high school?
Yes, for 5 years. And then
what about university age?
Then I moved after I graduated from high school. I was like, I don't know what to do. And at that time, I was with my girlfriend.
Not university age years, but like 18, 23.
Yeah, my girlfriend said, hey, my dad's been living in Dallas for a little bit. You want to go check it out? So I moved to Dallas. Like, I was expecting Dallas to be like stockyard, like people riding horses. And then, you know,
wearing
cowboy hat,
cowboy boots,
just running desert, around. Yeah, exactly.
Cactus,
and I got
coyote.
Here, exactly. And I got here, I was like, what the hell? My first restaurant I ever went to was Champs. Champs in Las Colinas. And I remember walking in.
Yeah.
And I was like, what the hell is that place? Like TV screen everywhere, sports everywhere. I was like, it's like Disneyland for freaking...
Unlimited queso, probably.
Exactly.
Ooh.
And then the drinks was like that big. You had like order a plate. You have like, yeah, hey, I just want a chicken breast. You eat like a whole chicken.
How crazy was it for you? Because like I know in France...
Yes, the portion was
I would
was
be
smaller.
So upset about the drinks, mainly.
Yeah, because in France, you don't have any free refill.
No.
You order a Coke, you got that Mexican Coke. With 3 cubes of ice, and that's it. When
that's
you're done,
it.
You're done. If you want more, you got to buy more.
No more.
Yeah, wow. But like for me, like
no free refill in France.
The thing that was amazed by is the size, the portion of the food. Like here is you like
see it's cool to see it like from the opposite end because you were like, damn, this is insane. This is I got more than I need. When the other way around, it's like,
yeah, like what is
I'm starving.
This?
I'm starving. I'm starving. Give me more.
Like, I need more.
Yeah. I need 3 of these $24.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. And like, yeah, the portion was like, it's like a family size pack in France, you know?
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
But anyway, and then.
Is that what made you stay?
Yeah. That was like, yes, I loved it. And then after that,
it's
like.
The best deal of my life.
Yeah. After that, I started joining the Dallas Hello Queens because I was like, I didn't know anybody here. And I was like, let's start playing rugby again. I joined the Queens, the Osada Queens, and I went to the pitch expecting it was like the best thing. I could show up, no lights, no locker room.
Nothing. And a little different from France.
Yeah, and at that time, the Queens were playing in Super League. Super League was kind of like the...
I remember.
Yeah, old school.
Oh, yeah.
MLR. When it was like...
Yeah.
Glendale, Chicago, Nyack, all those teams.
Oh, yeah,
and I was
like,
how the hell... That team is playing in a professional with no locker room, no light to practice, and they're just like traveling. I was like, there's something known. And then I joined the Queens and I just stayed for them until forever, I would say, until like last year. Last year I was Coach Lane, who's now the GM for the Dallas Jaguars.
I know, that's awesome.
Yes, came and started coaching us, and they were like, then when she became the GM for the Jaguars, said, hey, Frenchie, just lose some weight, get fit, and then let's just keep going. Last year, she was like, I was supposed to be a development player, and then they didn't happen. And then this year, I was just, for the whole year, I just keep working out. And then she was like, hey, let's do it again. And I was like, yep, let's do it again. And I'm very lucky to be roommate with this guy.
Hell yeah.
You know what I mean? And living my best life, man. It's like a dream. Like, honestly, like, every day.
Well, Frenchie, you're a savage. I'll give it to you, brother. Go fucking nuts out there on the field. I love it, man.
I've seen it.
Funny, bro. He's got great in the best intensity. I'll give it to you, Frenchie. Best and a lot of other great.
Yeah. Best thing that I could say to start out a career in the MLR is Frenchie's career comes in first game against Austin, takes the first carry he gets,
just smashes the cup.
Gets tackled, falling forward. So he's like leaning forward, and the guy grabs his pants and just ass exposed on TV. Just first
full
carry,
moon, full moon,
full moon, first carry. I was running over to go like get set up for the next pass, and just I was laughing at myself on the way there. I was like, that is a first carry in the MLR.
Frenchie, at least it's memorable. That's memorable.
Oh, February. And then after that, I forgot I was
on. Is it on YouTube?
Probably Rugby Network.
Do we want to bury it and so just put it away?
And after that, I forgot I was being filmed. I got into an argument with a dude. And I started flicking him off. I was like, shit. I forgot I was playing like professional league and with TV. And I was like, God damn, I hope I don't get cited for
the
that.
The mics pick up everything.
Yes, exactly.
Get up, you're like, fuck yeah. And like you just hear it on the mic.
It was not Morse. It was just like me just cursing.
Honestly, you know what? That's part of the game. People want that.
It's a violent game. The best part about rugby is that, like, even this past weekend, forgot who, the number 19 for Houston, but me and him were just going at it. Like, I was throwing him on the ground after rucks. Like, I'd clear him out, hold him down for a second. He'd punch me. I'd get back up. We'd, like, just go back to playing right after, like, our, like, whatever debate we had, I would say. But after the game, we see we're shaking hands. We give each other a hug. It's all love, that's the best thing about rugby. Yeah. I mean, if that's the main thing you got to understand when you're playing rugby, like in football, like you have a bet, you have a game against somebody, you're cursing, talking like shit to each other. After the game, you kind of want to fight the guy. Mm. You don't even in football, you don't even
you're supposed to hate the team after the other team.
In rugby, like you're sitting there with them after eating, having a beer, talking, just how's it going over there? How's it going?
Yeah,
you don't even have to know the person. That's the best part.
In rugby is like what happening on the field. Stay on the field for 80 minutes. I hate you, but after those 80 minutes, you're my brother. And then like and usually what's funny is like we talk about like what can I do better, what he can do better. We just like exchange it like to make us better.
Absolutely.
But like for 80 minutes, I hate you for like, and like I hope I can kill you.
It's controlled chaos.
Exactly. Yeah.
And you know what better sport for America than rugby?
Exactly.
Because channel all types of energy you got.
It's all inclusive.
Towards the game. That challenge you in every way, mentally, physically, spiritually.
Like I was saying, it's all inclusive. Like, I mean, you got guys on the field that are massive, and you guys on the field that are tiny.
Yeah, like Todd.
Like from every...
little...
But still, like you got the... And the like,
yo,
like,
shout out Todd.
Shout out Todd.
I feel like Todd's a unit. I've seen him.
Yeah.
He's like 5'7".
No,
he's like
1 foot tall, but 1 foot wide. It's like that. This is Todd. Todd, here we go. This is Todd right here. One by one.
Funny.
So
he's gonna fucking kill you.
Yeah,
he's gonna catch you on a fucking line.
I know. He's gonna take up my knee. But like for me, rugby really like no matter where you go in the world, if you don't know anybody, find your local rugby club, and then I promise you. You'll find the best people.
The best friends you'll ever have.
Exactly. Like, they don't know you out of nowhere. But if you need anything, they will give you the house. They will give you the car. They will give you a shirt and a bag.
You don't have anywhere to stay. They'll be like, stay on my couch.
Exactly.
Stay on my floor. Exactly.
Like, I promise you, the community, the community, like, rugby community is so...
The best out of any sport in the world.
100%.
No other sport.
Not even. It's not toxic.
Yeah.
Yeah. No other sport is as violent and then as communal.
Yeah.
As rugby.
Exactly. It's like.
It was hard to adjust to when I first started. I don't know about y'all. Or you played football.
I mean, I played. The best thing about rugby was that, like, you go to practice.
It took me like one game, but
you're not getting, like, in practice in football, like, they're calling you piece of shit, talking, just talking. Like, you do bad in film, you're just sitting there watching the same play over and over and over and over, and just getting, like, ridicule. You get embarrassed about it. You can't even, like, sometimes you don't feel like you can even go up to your coach and, like, have a conversation. Where in rugby,
yeah,
the coaches, I mean, they tell you, you could just tell when they're disappointed in your play or whatever like that, or maybe you're having a bad practice. You could tell that they
sometimes you get yelled at.
You get yelled at, but you're not getting, like,
but you know,
you're
not the coach cares.
You're not getting belittled because of it.
Right.
That's the main thing I felt like with football. They would belittle you. Like, I remember one time I was at Colorado State. And I was standing next to my coach, like, he was probably in front of me a little bit.
Yeah.
And all the D-line sitting around, he's like, where the fuck's fat ass Tucci? And I was like, yeah, I'm right here. Like, I'm right next to you. I heard everything.
Right here,
bitch. Like, I heard everything you said.
Yeah.
I heard it.
Yeah.
Like, but, like, that's the type
of shit. Not good for a coach to say that about a player.
And you're 18, 19, 20 years old, even, and it's like, you know, it takes effect on you as much as you don't want to fucking say it. You don't want to be like...
Oh, it absolutely does.
You don't want to be if you voice your opinion, you know, you're being a bitch.
Because you care about the game, you care about the team.
Yeah.
You're going to feel bad. Coach, who you're supposed to be listening to and looking up to a degree, is talking shit about you.
Exactly.
That would fuck me up the most when I was in high school. Exactly. Like, coach was pissed, I was like... this is the worst.
You're gonna have like a terrible. It's gonna be a terrible time of practice. You gotta like worry about running and all this extra shit. But
puking, dying.
There's other coaches I've had in football that have, like, you know, they can yell at me and curse me out and stuff. But I knew it was coming from a good place.
1,000%.
But then I also know there was other coaches that coached me that I knew was coming from, like, a malicious place. Like, they just didn't like me as a person, no matter how much I changed or how much anything. Like,
yep.
They just did not like me. But it's all good. I mean, if I saw him today, I'd say hi.
Hell yeah. I would say hi too.
I'd say hi.
You know what? No matter what, I'll still say hi. You love to see it, boys. Well, we just covered two fan-fucking-tastic. Maybe we'll beep that. Maybe we won't. Or maybe we will, or maybe we won't. But I'm just fired up because those two journeys have... stretched far and wide across the entire, across 48% of the globe. Yeah. It sounds like
definitely.
I'll be honest with you, man.
It's now here in Dallas, which is just another chapter
out here.
My only regret about rugby, like, I wish I would travel more. But it's okay, brother, like, you know what
with
I mean?
The Jackals. Like, I mean, a lot of places.
No, with the Jackal, like, just like
you want to go to, like. Malaysia. Yeah.
No.
Like Ukraine.
No, go to New Zealand or go like I did in Ireland.
Go to Siberia.
I like, but the
Siberia,
thing is,
they go hard at rugby.
Yeah, they play a lot of league out there too.
Yeah, they play snowball.
No, they actually are. Am I right in that? Don't they play something?
They play rugby out in Siberia. I had a friend, Monte Gattis, who played out there for professionally.
Siberia.
Siberia.
Yeah, Siberia. Yeah. That would be the last place I would play.
Yeah.
Like, it's always freaking cold.
I mean, not me, but him, for sure. I mean, yeah, I'm sure it was just an experience, just like out of all ours.
Yeah, it's probably the worst experience of his life.
Oh, no. He's a...
Siberia.
Siberia.
Man, do you have Siberia on your bucket list?
Nope.
Frenchie?
Why not?
I mean, it depends. If I end up there, I end up there. If not, like, I mean, fuck. I don't even know where Siberia really is. Russia?
I don't even know.
Siberia is like up north of Russia. Like,
sounds like a type of tiger,
like,
breed.
Siberia,
that's going
No, Siberia is like probably one of the coldest places ever, man. There's nothing. Just
I
want
to go to like
ice,
nothing. I want to go to like East Europe one time just because it's just Croatia. Even though it's like. It looks like, you ever seen a Eurotrip when they go to like nowhere near Berlin? Fucking they end up like in the middle of nowhere where like a nickel can get them though. Like,
no, but you guys are joking. Like I'll be honest with you. You're like Eastern Europe, like if you go to Croatia, Google Croatia. One of my best friends.
Brother, I've been.
And?
most beautiful place in the world. Yeah.
Like, you know, this little creek with the sea.
But I thought we're talking Russia. If we're talking Croatia, I back Croatia.
But like, that's Eastern Europe.
I mean, Russia's a little more east.
No, but like, if you say Eastern Europe, Croatia
is
Eastern
Europe. Right.
Like, you know, you go like Budapest.
Yep.
Budapest.
I haven't been to Budapest.
Like, no, I haven't been to any of those places.
Yeah. But like, one of my best friends, Duncan Forbes, when he said, he traveled a lot. He's like a backpacker. And he said, like, I asked him, if you could pick one place that I must visit in my life, he said Croatia. So what he did, he went to Croatia as a backpacker. And over there he did for 1 week.
Yep.
You just get on a boat and then you hop, like Highland hopping for 1 week with a bunch of backpackers on the yacht. And he said it was the best experience ever.
How'd he get on the yacht?
No, because it's like a cruise. It's like a cruise. It's like a yacht. It's like a cruise.
Something
like this. Like a resort. That's something that you pay and you do it. You know what I mean?
Hell yeah.
Another thing that he did, by the way, is like, it's called the Mongolian race.
Mongolian race.
Yeah. So what? It's like a month's race when you start from London. Yeah. You need to buy a car for $2,000 and you drive from London all the way to Mongolia.
Oh, shit.
And then at the end of the...
Bro, Mongolia like still exists? Race.
Yes. What the fuck?
I thought...
Where'd it go? Is Mongolia real?
Genghis Grill still exists, so Mongolia still exists.
Oh, that's right. Shout out Genghis Grill.
Yeah. And then when you get
to... Where you go get food? Is that like a food spot, a Mongolian grill?
It's like a hibachi.
Hibachi Mongolian grill.
So if that exists, is it real?
Yeah, yes. It's pretty fun.
I don't know.
It's pretty good.
And then when you get to Mongolia...
Good place for soldier fuel.
When you get to Mongolia, you give the car to a local.
Yeah.
So you just like, but every day, like, you start from London, and every day you have like checkpoint with all the team.
It's called a Mongolian run.
Mongolian run. Yes. Check on YouTube. It's awesome. That's like a 1 month trip when you go like from London all the way to Mongolia.
What do you get if you complete it with this $2,000 car?
Nothing. You don't get anything. It's just like a trip of a lifetime. And every day you do like checkpoint when you party with everybody. And you like...
There's other people doing it?
Yes. It's not just you. It's
with like the same $2,000 car is a key piece of the puzzle. You have to have a piece of shit car.
Yes. Yes.
You're going to have the trip of your lifetime. Yeah. But your car might fucking explode.
Yeah.
Exactly.
You have to Flintstone it.
Pete, Brother Ham.
Bro,
I promise
I'll look it
Google
up.
Google it. Mongolian race. And I would love to do that with you if you're keen.
Brother Ham, man. I'd love to do that. Maybe we bring our daughters.
No. You don't want to bring your daughter there. It's like,
maybe in 25 years.
Yeah, but by that time, I don't want to do that. I'll be chilling like in Cancun, drinking fucking mojito, and then with you.
Fair enough.
And now a word from our sponsors.
Howdy there, ladies and gents. It's your good friend, Commercial Break Peter. Here to let you know that today's episode is brought to you by Unify Commerce. Say it with me now. Unify Commerce. Yes, guys, that is spelled UNIFICommerce.com. Guys, Unify is in fact my company, and I thought I'd go ahead and plug them on here so you guys can know a little bit of what I do outside of having a great time on the podcast. Guys, Unify is a social technology company that simply helps other companies take their social presence to the next level. Simple as that. And the primary service I want to highlight is professional video creation. Guys, if your company is in need of an exceptional video that shows what you do, why you do it, how you do it, and why it is so valuable, then Unify is here to help. And Unify can create an exceptional advertisement that can really help build awareness and drive sales for your company. We have been in business since the summer of 2018 and helping businesses grow and capitalize on the opportunities that social presence can offer is something we love to do. So if you need a next level video, you need a next level team on your side, and that is Unify. So guys, go ahead and visit unificommerce.com if you want to learn more. And if you want to inquire about working with us, simply go to the Work With Us tab and we would love to connect. Anyways, y'all, back to the show.
Ladies and gents, welcome back to the good old Ham Planet podcast. We're fired up. We're tuned up. We're jazzed up. We're high energy. We're feeling like a million bucks.
Yes.
Because we got Alex Tucci and we got Frenchie in the building, baby. Brothers, what is your most memorable rugby victory?
Ooh. I would
Yeah, we'll go Tucci first.
Yeah, we'll go me first. Yeah. I would say probably against Houston. It was the first year in the MLR, and the week before I was battling a hamstring injury, and I came in the second half, had a big try, scored, and we had like a big comeback to like push us into the playoffs. So I would probably say that's probably my like. I mean, there, even last year, I can even say like there was
where were y'all playing?
We were playing in Utah.
Was it cold as shit?
No, it was in the summer. It was like towards the end of the season.
Oh, perfect weather.
Yeah, so it was amazing weather, and my hamstring was just I literally had it taped up, and just I remember I just got the ball, ran through contact, and no one was touching me. I was like, all right, I'm through. Went through, ended up scoring under the post, and from there out, I think after literally on the next kickoff, we went coast to coast and scored again, and it gave us the lead. So it was huge. It was crazy. That was definitely a big moment. Just because I mean I battled through the injury, and it was a big try. It was a big, you know, confidence builder. I feel like on top of everything. So
oh, absolutely.
Yeah, I'd say that's probably my.
That's badass.
Adrenaline had to be pumping through that hamstring.
Oh yeah, it was weird.
Taped it up, just kind of slapped it on there.
I mean, I did a bunch of rehab the week before and stuff, and then just like literally just wrapped it with like a bunch of that like some like thick white tape, like almost like spongy material.
Did that help?
Yeah, it did.
It did?
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
I think for a hamstring, you just put like it's got to have pressure on it after tweaked it. I didn't have it pulled. I didn't pull my hamstring. I just like tweaked it.
You almost cut the blood coming in.
Hamstring's tough.
You almost cut the blood coming in and just
hamstring. All legs are tough. Yeah. Ankles are the worst.
Yeah.
Bro. Quads, calves.
What about knees for him?
Knees. For an ACL. Yeah.
Brother, you tore an ACL?
Yep. Two years ago.
Rug burn.
Back now, stronger?
Oh, yeah. I feel way better. I mean, I don't know. I don't know how I feel compared differently, but I mean, I feel really good now.
It's crazy.
It takes a long time, like, even just to feel, like, if it's able to go through, like, you know, impact and stuff after, like, a year and some months after. But then even then, you still got more work to do.
It's such a hurdle.
You got so much more work to do because, you know.
Oh, brother, absolutely.
I feel like when you get, like, an injury, like, after even when you, like, think fully heal, you need to go, like, that mentally click. Yeah. Be, like, full on. We have a guy in our team called, like, Mo. Shout out to Mo.
Captain. Shout out Mo.
Shout out Mo. He had, like, a big, like, knee injury. And yep. Like you had to learn how to run again.
Yeah, you have to learn.
It's a salute to any player that comes back from those.
They're very easy to come back. I mean, not easy, but you can do it. The main thing is just staying consistent with it. Like every time I see somebody in a big knee brace, I'm like, oh, did you tear your ACL? They're like, yeah. They're like, I don't know how I'm gonna get back to it. I'm like, just do all the rehab they tell you to do. And then after you get done with your physical therapy, just keep doing it every day. And then you'll work out, get back into your normal life after a couple months.
And I'll be honest with you, like because of that, that's something like for me, especially American player, because you guys start playing rugby at a like way older age than European.
Yeah.
I feel like your body's not like trained to hinder those kind
get
of
get up
like,
in the mic,
hit.
Brother.
Yeah, like you guys like are not trained to get into those like type of contact and stuff.
You can move it too if you need to. You got that whole. You can pick it up. You guys can go like this.
So like I feel like you guys are not used to the contact and the impact of it. So your body is not like trained to get those impact. And I feel like it's way easier for you.
It depends. I feel like, because
I'll be honest with you, like if you look in like every team that I played. Like if you're foreigners, like I play with a couple foreigners. You guys never get like knee problem.
Right.
But you guys, especially with like guys who come from footballs, if they play, if you're not lineman, if you're like more like a wide receiver and stuff, your knees are not used to get chopped.
Oh yeah.
So your knee is very like weak. I'm not saying like you guys don't do the job of everything, but your body is not conditioned.
Never injured my knee in rugby.
Exactly. But your body's not conditioned to those hits.
I mean, it's sometimes now knees are like, it's because of the players just being too strong. Like they say, like a lot of knee injuries happen just because people are so strong and their cuts in, like in the NFL is a huge like issue.
Right.
Like, yeah. Saquon Barkley, like he tore his ACL just making a cut. Tore my ACL making a cut. It wasn't even like contact injury. I did it literally to myself.
I remember like Bo Jackson. Look at Bo Jackson. What a fucking Superman.
Got all that.
Bo Jackson is a Superman.
Inertia.
Yeah, Bo Jackson. Yeah. Bo Jackson is like a Superman in real life. Look how he got injured. Like his career ending was on the run when his hip just
pulled off a piece of his, like his hamstring pulled a piece of his hip off.
Yes.
That's how like much force was into that.
Right.
I could fucking only imagine that. Probably
for me, that guy,
Barry
Sanders'
force is probably not. They need to do like a sports science on that.
Yeah. To be honest with you, for me, Bo Jackson is the ultimate Superman. Nobody would be stronger or better football player.
Is that your guy, Frenchie? Bo Jackson?
Yes. Yes, definitely. Bo Jackson is the ultimate athlete.
He is he's up there.
Bo Jackson would be Bo Jackson.
Deion Sanders. No, up there too.
Herschel Walker.
Herschel Walker's a manimal.
Yeah. Yeah. And I would
guy was doing full blown MMA at 49. Yeah, exactly.
And like lucky for me when I was working at the Drakener, he was used to be a regular customer for me. So he used to come all the time. When he was 50, and that guy was fitter than any.
Bro, he's still swolled up. He can still
play
running back.
Trap. It was Trap City every day.
Bro,
and now a word from our sponsors.
Today, ladies and gents, I am going to give three simple things that anyone can do that helps the show tremendously. And I'll go ahead and let you guys know that the Hand Planet Podcast, as of now, as of March 1st, 2022, it is a one-man operation. I'm the director, host, scheduler, video editor, promoter. You name it, everything about the show, as of now, is all done by me. And it's definitely taught me a lot, but it definitely isn't the easiest task. So if I'm able to help, that doesn't require much effort, much time, and zero money from people who support the show, that would be fantastic. So today, we're here to cover three things that anyone can do that help the Hand Planet Podcast. Number one, ladies and gents, number one is to simply invite your Facebook friends to like the page. All you got to do is go to Facebook, type in Hand Planet Podcast. It'll take you to our page. You will then see a section that says invite friends. Click select all. It sends your friends a little notification. It's not too overbearing and it invites them to like the page. This is tremendously valuable. And more importantly, it allows the show to connect with new audiences, new potential guests, and so much good comes from it. And it is so valuable. And it takes less than 60 seconds. That is number one. Number two, ladies and gents, is to provide a good old 5-star review on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and or Facebook. As reviews are the bread and butter to any business, this is a show. Need him for the show too. I'm a work in progress. I know this mustache is a work in progress, but your reviews mean the world to me. You don't have to write a love letter, but if I want to be able to become one of the top podcasts in the world, I need support and need your valued feedback. If you're able to give a review on Apple Podcasts or Facebook, helps tremendously. That action also will take less than 50 seconds. Y'all is engage. What I mean by engage is simply feel free to share anything, feel free to comment on anything, say whatever you want. I welcome it with open arms. I love hearing feedback and it helps tremendously. You can engage on our page via Facebook, engage on our Instagram. We've got Ham Planet, and we also have at Ham Planet Clips. And we're on TikTok. I gave in. All the kids are doing it, so now we're doing it. TikTok at Ham Planet Clips. And, of course, YouTube, Planet Podcast Clips. It's been doing great, and I would love your support there as well. So, engage with the podcast, comment, like, subscribe. Let me know what you think about the show.
message me, send me any recommendations or guest requests. I'm all with open arms. Ladies and gents, that's going to wrap up the video for today. These are three simple actions that you can do that will help the Ham Planet podcast promote. With that being said, ladies and gents, see your beautiful face. Great day. I love you.
We are scooting and booting along in the episode. More good vibes in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Shout out to Culver Military Academy. Well, you know, it was a great school. We'll leave it at that on that end. Loved every second of it.
But that show.
What about Euphoria?
It's you great. Hey, by the way, I have a question for you, Peter.
Wait, Euphoria?
I have a question for you, Peter.
Okay, here we go, brother.
What about you tell us about your rugby history? Because you always ask questions towards us, but we want to ask you a question. One question, which is, tell us about your rugby history.
Brother, excellent question. Appreciate the question.
Of course.
So, to rewind the clocks, brother, we grew up in Texas. So, everyone in Texas, you played football as a kid.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And if you didn't, you were a pussy. Honestly, okay. that was the consensus. Like, at least in my town, if you're playing football, good.
Yeah,
if you're not, call it maybe you're going to be a cheerleader or some shit.
Yeah, what about Cheers? That TV show is pretty good.
I'm sure it is. I'm sure. No disrespect to Cheer. I mean, the male. Anyways, that was my thing. So, played football, was a lineman, was a tackle.
Yeah.
Fucking shitty position, honestly. Shitty job.
I had fun when I played tackle.
I mean, it's fun. I mean, it's
better than like guard or center.
Right. Like, it's like it could be worse position.
Yeah, it could be worse.
Yeah, it's like a could be worse position.
It's a position you get put at when you're the tallest guy, really, like that's big.
Right. You're a tall guy, big guy, can push someone down and, you know, smash your face in. Need you at tackle.
Yeah.
So, it was a long time tackle. And played the end as well. And then played varsity my freshman year, which was nice.
Yeah.
So at that point, my whole family, Texan family, was like, all right, playing football, P's doing good. Oh, you might get a, you're going to go somewhere maybe for football. And then that freshman year.
That didn't happen.
After I finished playing football, played basketball. Yeah, Frenchie, you're like Nostradamus, brother. It didn't happen. Because I played rugby that spring. So I was 15.
And you became a man.
Yeah. And I literally started just growing chest hair immediately when I picked up the rugby ball. Which I don't have a lot right now because we just shaved it for that OnlyFans thing.
You're going to make the money, man, baby. Hey.
Link in bio.
Hey, catch his king. Catch his king.
Link in bio. No, we actually don't have an OnlyFans, ladies and gents. We'll shoot our listeners straight, but yeah, probably won't get one. I don't know. Let us know in the comments. So, brother, found rugby, played lock my first year. Loved the fact that I could run the ball. I was like, fuck, this is what I've been waiting for.
Yeah.
I've been a lineman my whole life. I've been a fucking guy blocking,
no glory,
pushing,
no glory.
It, like defensive end, some a little glory. Bit more fun, yeah. Some yeah. glory,
yeah,
but it's still,
yeah,
tackle, whew, you're fucking mopping the floors,
yeah, literally,
yes, you're like the janitor,
the janitor.
You get paid the most if you go make it to the NFL as a tackle,
yeah, but yeah. I mean,
but. You know, there's only...
As you can see, yeah, we're here like, doing no, a podcast.
Yeah,
you
don't yeah there's only five Tyron Smiths in the world.
Exactly. Yeah, you don't see any highlight about, like, a tackle, all
right? Right, right. And, brother, played rugby, loved the game. And that following sophomore year, went to football camp. And on one day, I was practicing, still playing lineman, trained super hard to be tight end or fullback. Like, I was like, no matter what, I'm going in this year and I'm going to get one of these positions.
Yeah.
So I like leaned up. I was shredded. I had a fucking six pack. And I was like a former lineman.
I mean, you didn't eat enough.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I needed some meat. Brother, they kept me at line. And I remember I came out of practice, had this rash on my chin from wearing my chin strap, and was still playing lineman. And I was like, fuck this shit. Yeah. I'm playing rugby. So after that, committed to rugby and just made it like my only sport.
Yeah.
Only sport. And I also wrestled just to supplement to like, because it helps a ton with tackling.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
We all know. Yeah.
Yeah, be honest with you, like the wrestler are probably the best
tacklers.
Like, tacklers. And yeah. Like for like, if you want to transition to another, if you want to transition to another sport, if you're a wrestler, rugby is perfect for you.
Yeah.
See it, love it, love to see it. Back to the show.
Tucci, what's your goal of how many years you want to play rugby at the professional level?
I always say 35 is a good landmark, I feel like, to go for. So that's what I want to, like, play.
Is that it?
Like, that's, like, and if I can play past that, then great. If I can't, then I'm hoping something picks up where it's, like, I mean, not hoping, but, I mean, I know what I want to do. I would definitely want to be in, like, the industry of either, like, fitness or sales, or even if, like, my Twitch channel would, like, blow up to a big enough where it's like,
brother, yeah,
a lot of money, like money coming in.
Yeah,
that's enough to like sustain and live on. And
brother, can we give a letter by letter channel? Yeah.
So twitch.tv/slimtucci, SlimTucci. I go live pretty much every
Slim
day.
Slim Tucci, heard it here first, folks.
At least one time a day, unless I'm like traveling for rugby or playing a rugby game, I won't be on. But other than that, I'm always on screaming at my computer.
He's a funny
Call of Duty with my boys. Basically,
Call of Duty's the game of choice.
Yeah, it used to be Fortnite. And as far as like streaming goes, I mean, I've grown up. I played.
Hey, Frenchie, I got an opener for you, brother.
Yeah.
Slamming on the desk.
Sorry.
Frenchie's a beauty.
Yeah. Here, hey. You got a lighter? Here, give me the lighter. I can do it with the lighter.
I can do that. Just give me. Yeah,
was using that for the candle.
Yeah, whatever. Sorry. Thank you.
There we go.
Cheers.
Frenchie, no worries, brother. I mean, nothing wrong with it. I've done it.
Yeah.
I if I can prevent it, I do.
Yeah, it's okay. Hey, work smarter, not harder.
Yeah. So, just always wanted it. Like, when I first saw streaming, I was watching like a Facebook gaming, and there was this, I think his name was Dark or something like that, Dark something, but it was like him and his friends just playing Fortnite,
just
going at it, and I was like, that'd be cool to do. So then, you know, Fortnite was like the big game in that I feel like got a lot of people just into streaming in general.
Fortnite lost its spark though?
No, it's actually, I mean, it's probably
bigger than ever.
I think I was last time I checked, it was like
buy Fortnite stock.
It's kind of like one of those games where
there's
3 million people playing that game at any given time, whereas Call of Duty, it's like, I think, 300,000.
But my question for you, Tucci, like, so what makes you started streaming?
I just saw it and I was like, I basically anything I want that I do, it's like I saw it and I did it and I was like, oh, I want to do that.
Okay.
And I just went and just did what I had to do to do it. And then I started on like an Xbox, just streaming off the Xbox with like a webcam hooked up to the Xbox. And it was just like very low quality, shitty. But
you gotta start from the ground up.
Exactly.
And then I just kept doing it. And then, you know, people start tearing like, oh, you stream? Oh, yeah, I do that. And then it was like, you know, I had some help with one of my friends, Adrian, aka Snow Shots.
So shout out Snow Shots.
Snow Shots. He's one of my really good friends. But anyway, he streams. And
what a beauty.
He had a computer and everything. And I was looking at his stream and like, damn, that's fucking sick. And then, it kind of plays in with the rugby as well, too, because, when I tore my ACL, I just went back to Utah to rehab, and then that was a COVID year, so everything shut down. And we were doing like a virtual reality, like MLR league, where it's like players from each team.
Yep, I remember.
Yeah, so I represented the Utah team, and
rugby. Yeah.
Yeah, playing a rugby video game, and it was streamed on Twitch. And
every time
we were doing them, I would just kind of just make like, you know, be funny and just like be animated and stuff. And then
that was great that y'all did that.
Yeah. So we did that. And then a couple of weeks later, I get like message from like the league, like one of the PR people. And he's like, hey, we want to, we're going to be putting an MLR player into this Twitch stream aid for COVID, and it's a bunch of famous people, and we want you to represent the league. And I was like, oh,
dang.
Like, do you have streaming equipment and stuff? I was like, I have a webcam on my Xbox. That's really what I use. And like, okay, we'll get you a PC. So that was my first introduction to getting a PC.
No way.
Was through that.
Wow.
I didn't get to keep the PC, but I mean, it got me, like, I had the PC, and once I had it and saw how everything ran on it, I was like, once I have to give this back, which is like 2 months later, I'm gonna.
That's a good rental they gave.
Yeah, yeah. Hey. Like a 2 month rental.
Yeah,
I mean, honestly, like, for me, it's exclusive because I never heard that story. Like, for me, I thought it was like a like legit streamer who's been doing it for a long, long time.
So yeah,
because like the first time I talked to Tucci, and then because the coach Alain said, "Hey, you're gonna be roommate with Tucci," I said, "Okay, awesome. Send me his number." And then we started talking. And said, "Hey, man, I'm glad we roommate, but like, I gotta be honest with you, like, I'm a very light guy sometimes. Like, I stream. So for me, I was like, okay, that guy's been doing it for a long, long time. He's a pro. Yeah. He makes money. Good for him. Like, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
And like that for me, that's a new story. Like, I didn't know he started like not long ago. I thought it was like an OG type of streamer, man.
It was like, I was streaming before that, but it was just such
low quality.
Right. Like, it was just for, and I wasn't even like affiliated yet. So then once they got me the PC, I did the COVID thing. They were like, okay, we're gonna pair an athlete or someone famous with a streamer.
Yep.
And I was like, okay, cool. What am I in? They're like, it's an Uno tournament. So I'm playing literally Uno on a computer with this other streamer.
Who doesn't love Uno?
It was a fun time.
Like, do you know the real rule about Uno? You have your own rule. That's a rule about Uno, man. Can you do like +4, +4, +4, +2?
I don't remember how to play it, but it's just a cool color.
Okay, about a cool story about Tucci, like to show you how much he's invested into his Twitch.
Oh, yeah.
Like and stuff. Because the first time that we went to Walmart, the first thing is like, I need to buy the screen. Okay, that guy's serious about it. So we went to Walmart, and one of the first things that he bought was one of like a new screen for his Twitching thing. And I was like, okay, that guy's serious about it.
Yeah.
Just to show you how much that guy's invested in his journey.
I carry my PC, like when I go on the planes and stuff, like to go back and forth, I have like my carry on is my PC.
Exactly.
And I pull it out, I secure it into like, holy, I'm like, I have a whole PC.
Yeah. And when I pick him up before I pick him up at the airport, he's like, hey, how much luggage? You guys like, okay, I got my luggage, but I have also my PC. He was like, bro, that guy is
hell yeah.
And like, Tucci, to be honest,
I love it.
As a good roommate, I show him support. I don't know if you know about that, but on Twitch, you can buy subscriber for other people. So for example, if you subscribe, you can buy a membership. I can buy a membership for you. So the first like a couple weeks ago, I said, hey, I bought like 4 or 5.
I need to get into one of these member club. I gotta.
Yeah,
Tucci's, of course.
Yeah, yes. No, just companies. I mean, it's one of those things where like I really don't like.
It's great that we have these.
It's great making money from streaming. It's not a lot of money.
It's deserved, but it's deserved.
It's just
it's cool. Entertainment.
Like exactly.
So when I got put in that thing with the Uno, I was with this streamer part of like Down the Quest. It's called, and they're like a 420. Like weed house, so I was like, hysterical that they paired a professional athlete up with a weed house streaming.
Well, you know, in Colorado, it's 2020,
so it was cool though. But then after, so I was in the Discord, you know what Discord is, I'm assuming.
Yeah.
I was in a big Discord chat, and there's people in this Discord chat. It's like John Legend, Odell Beckham Jr., Mike Evans, like all these people are in it, like all these like high profile celebrities, and me. And then I see there's like a Fortnite section, and I was like, I need to get in that. So I messaged one of the guys that was talking to for the Uno. And I was like, hey, is there any room in the Fortnite? He was like, yeah, send me another guy's thing. I messaged him. He's like, yeah, we got a spot for you. I'll let you know later. So I get done with the Uno stream. Everyone's great. The league is like, oh, you represent us well. Thank you so much. And I'm laying on the couch. And I get a message on Discord. It's like, hey, we got a team for you. I was like, okay, for the Fortnite tournament? They're like, yeah. I was like, all right, who's my team? They're like, Nick A30, who's like one of Fortnite's biggest streamers right now on Twitch.
Sounds famous and familiar.
Blake Snell, who's a pitcher for the San Diego Padres, the Cy Young Award winner, really cool guy. And then Joe Jonas,
the Jonas brother.
Those are my teammates and I was the fourth one. And like, I get in a party with them, and I'm like, I'm in a party right now with Nick A30, Joe Jonas, and Blake Snell. Like, and then it's
who
just
are you
me.
Most hyped about? It's like, if I can ask
I mean,
that.
It was probably like Nick A30, just because I know he was such a big streamer. Me and Blake Snell were probably like related the most to each other just because we're athletes.
Yeah.
And we were like, cool. Like, you know, like as far as like we spoke the same language, I should say.
But like, did you feel and like then, out of place?
No, because I was honestly talking more than Blake was to Nick and Joe. Me and Joe actually had a conversation about rugby because his wife is from England.
Oh, wow.
And they're a huge rugby fan, awesome. Like family.
Okay.
So I was talking to him about that.
Love that.
It was just cool. Like, I mean, the experience alone. And then after that, like, I remember I went live the next day after that. And I had a bunch of people in my chat. And I was like, fuck, I got to keep this going so I can get like affiliate and
start
earning money off of it. And I was like, this is my chance. Like, this was my opening into it. Exactly. And then did that, got affiliate. I would like do like I always try one for my subscribers. I try and like make it so it's like it's nice to people that just do it just because they want to be subscribed. But I try and also do like giveaways, like with Utah, I gave away jerseys. I had like a bunch of jerseys.
Hell yeah. Like NFL or NBA jerseys or a rugby jersey.
Utah Warriors jerseys.
Fucking even better.
Yeah. So I signed them all and then I just would I'd be like, listen, if you subscribe. That's one vote, but you can gift subs, and the more subs you gift, the more it goes into the pool of names, so that you can have like,
ooh, I like that,
10 names, all your name, you know, 10,
yeah,
10,
yeah.
At the same time, I'm getting like, you know, profit from it, but at the same time, you're being entered to win this jersey. I had like 20 of them, so your chances of getting a jersey were higher.
A giveaway is great,
I just felt like it was like
got no risk, you got all the potential,
exactly.
If you just go get it.
Exactly. So that's what I try and
do. But you might still lose.
Exactly.
But I think it goes.
It was kind of crazy too because it was during COVID. Like everyone's
fucking
like
COVID.
My COVID was so. Everyone's like COVID. Was like, you know, they have
COVID this, COVID that.
They have these stories.
Ah,
like,
shit, we're gonna have to beep the fuck.
Oh, we can't say COVID.
Yeah, the lizards will beep it.
Yeah, they will. Okay, so anyway, during that time, everyone's getting their stimulus check. Everyone's getting their stimulus check too, so everyone's kind of blowing money on whatever the fuck they want at that point too. So they, you know, they're coming. I feel like there was just so many people subscribing to like
GameStop,
social media platforms and stuff like that, or wanting to donate money to people because they just had extra money.
AMC.
I had AMC. I sold it. Thank God. That thing is
Jesus Murphy.
The bottom GameStop. Fell out on that.
This is not a financial advice network.
No, financial like GameStop.
I don't know anything. I don't know anything.
So where were
Doge.
We? Where were we?
Twitch. So yeah, now I just basically go live with when I'm playing. I played Fortnite died out. I moved over to Call of Duty, but what was cool, I started
Slim Tucci, Twitch.
Yeah. Slim Tucci. I learned how to play mouse and keyboard with it.
And I'll be honest with you, as a roommate, I'll be honest with you, that guy is funny and he's such a just a good person to follow.
I can imagine.
Like, look, sometimes in the living room, just watching TV, and I hear him just like scream at it, making joke, and just enjoying like streaming for the people that are watching him. I'll be honest with you. And it's awesome. Because like, you know,
it's a beautiful thing to see.
So guys get like, you know, like into the process of making like, just like, okay, that's that amount of people watching me. So I need to be this person. But this guy doesn't do that. He's
stay true to yourself.
He's true to yourself. And that's what I like about him, man. I'll be honest with you. Like sometimes he's just scream at the freaking screen. Like,
fucking insane.
It doesn't matter if there's one viewer or 100,000 viewer, is the same thing. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like the number doesn't change.
I agree.
He's still true to himself and he's a fucking good streamer, man.
That's fucking important.
He's gonna shit on you if you don't fucking make your kill. But
one of the things in our world,
and that's what I mean. And that's what I like about him. You know,
produces longevity. Frenchie, love to see it. Toast to that. What a hell of a teammate.
Yeah.
Here we are, brothers. Yep, Diet Coke. Love to see
Diet
it.
Diet Coke. Yes. Nice little DC.
Yeah, I support my teammate. I support my roommate. I love him. I'm very, like I say, I told him before.
I love Frenchie too.
I couldn't ask for any better.
The same birthday.
Yeah, I know.
Exactly. You know what I mean? I couldn't ask for any better roommate than him.
Man. Same.
Because I was such like, I'll be honest with you.
You love to see it, boy.
You love
like,
it.
You know when you live with somebody every day.
Hell yeah, bro. It's a big.
You gotta walk on eggshells sometimes.
Exactly. With us, we're not.
There's no eggshells.
You do me. We spend time together. We spend time together. But after that, you and me. Yeah, I mean,
I've had rough times, like living.
Yeah,
you know,
I've had some sketchy living.
Been like, shit. Am I? Can I take out the trash right now? Am I gonna get shot?
No, but like for me, no. Like for me,
no,
like,
not
hey,
shot. I've never felt.
But like for me, like hey, the trash you really take out. I take it to trash. You know what I mean? Like,
I have good previous permits.
No, like I'll be honest with you.
The main thing for when you live with people, it's like it can go one of two ways. Either you guys have a great understanding of everything that's going on in the house, or
you don't,
or it's a war zone in the house and it's like everything is destroyed. Like there's sinks, dishes, and sink. It's like, I feel like when you're younger, when I was younger, like I lived in some places where like I wouldn't even go in the kitchen because it was just a battlefield.
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
It was disgusting. Like, the older I get, I'm just like, I need this clean. Like,
yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Fuck that.
And I'll be honest, like, sometimes, like, look,
we got a lot of soap inside of that. We're soaking those dishes for the record.
Nice.
Pete, sometimes, like, you know,
it's very clean.
Pete, sometimes, like, look,
we could use some work.
Like, Tucci is a big eater. He's a fucking massive man.
Okay? Brother, he's a unit. I can see.
And I'll be honest with you. Sometimes he leaves his stuff in the fucking like sink. I just, hey, let me just take it out, put it in the dishwasher. I'll wash it for him. Or even like sometimes he does his washing machine, like his laundry. I'll put it in the dryer and that's it. Like, it's not like we're keeping tab for each
other. Yeah.
Right.
And
that's teamwork at its finest.
Exactly.
Teamwork makes a dream work.
Teamwork at home.
Makes a dream work.
Exactly.
Honestly, is such a huge advantage, like being able to live with teammates, your team, players.
Oh, it's awesome. I mean, we live like all on the same floor.
Yes.
And it's just like everyone's
apartment. That's so great.
Like going to people's apartments, hanging out, watching TV. I feel like our apartment's like
a sharp unit.
A sharp unit.
A sharp unit.
Yes.
Yeah. Not like a frat house, brother.
Sharp unit.
Because we all live on the same floor in the same apartment complex. Like you come out on the balcony, you must see if one of the teammates just hanging out on the balcony and somebody in the pool. It's awesome. And like I'll be honest with you, compared to other teams, the fact that we have a very good setup and the fact that we all live in the same thing, if you need some help, like I don't know, working on the line out, working on like different play or stuff like this, you want to talk about like
knock on the door.
You just like knock on the door, you walk in, and we can just like knock it out.
Easy.
It's easy.
Fuck, boys, I love this.
I'll be honest with you, like, we really, and I like the chemistry that we have between each other, it's huge.
Yeah.
It's so huge, man. Fuck.
It's huge. Like I said.
I fucking love it, boys.
Yeah, because like we are the new team on the block. But
sorry, technical difficulties. Cameraman is drunk. Back to the show now.
Yes.
Brothers, where can the fine ladies and gentlemen who have been with us on this amazing evening or afternoon or morning or whatever you got going, because you know, in the galaxy of good vibes, it's all three at once. Brothers, any final words to the people?
I really don't have too many words. If you want to contact me more, hit me up on my social medias. I'm sure there'll be somewhere in some bio somewhere. If anything,
we'll plug them below.
Everything's basically Slim Tucci. So if you got any questions about anything, want to come by the stream, pop in. Really ain't got much to say. I'm pretty sure Frenchie's got a mouthful over here.
Pop in. I love to see it. Let's get the mouthful, Frenchie.
Yeah. So like, hey, I'll be honest with you. Like, thank you very much. Just watch the fucking podcast, because I'll be honest with you, both of those guys are like my brothers. I know like Pete for way longer than I wish I didn't, but like I believe with him, he'd be my brother.
Oh yeah.
Everything everywhere is Slim Tucci, he's my brother, support him. Cause it's a great like Twitch guy that I can stream and everything.
Oh yeah, thank you.
And then at the end of the day, like, you know what I mean? I'm just fucking Frenchie, you know what I mean? Like,
Frenchie's a beauty.
Yeah. Frenchie's a beaut.
And I appreciate, like, anybody who watch it, I'll be honest with you, just come to the fucking game.
Come support the Dallas Jackal.
Come
on, this is America's rugby team, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, exactly. I'll be honest with you, I will send you free tickets or, like discount code. You just come and support us.
Discount code. He'll get you a discount code.
Exactly. Like, give you discount code, whatever you need. Whatever you need. Just come support us.
Frenchie's a hell of a
man. Just
come
support us. And then, like, I appreciate, like, you know what I mean? I love you. Any single one of people that are just watching that show. And thank you very much for supporting my boys, him and my boy Tucci. That's what I am. I'm just a simple man.
And follow the Dallas Jackals. Exactly. On Instagram, YouTube, Facebook.
Everything.
Exactly.
Everything. And again, comment. Yeah. Get rowdy in the comments.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Let's fucking go.
If you want to catch up with me, just ask Peter M or Tucci. I'll give you my number.
Famous plug.
We love to see it. Ladies and gents, We had a fantastic time.
Yeah, great time.
Hope you had a fantastic time too. Brothers, an honor.
Brother.
A pleasure.
Let's take off.
Till next time.
Let's take off to the good vibe. Can we take off?
We are now going to strap in and blast even further into the galaxy of good vibes. We will see your beautiful faces very soon, ladies and gents. Let's fucking go!
Fucking hell, man.
I wish I had a fucking confetti or a shot.
Yeah.
A shotgun.
Fireworks going off in the background. Shotgun.
Yeah. Straight to the moon. Side by side, girl.
Yeah.
Fuck you. That would be